Good morning, everyone.
To begin our time together this morning, we have another short video from Leah Reeser Keller, our MCEC conference ministers. About 2 minutes, basically some Advent blessings from her.
Hi, MCEC family. It's Advent, the season where we begin to reflect on Jesus Christ, the light of the world, being born to us. And this is a year where I'm ready to enter into that longing for light more than ever. I am missing already the opportunities to be in person, at church, to be with family, all of the Christmas gatherings that begin to happen this time of year. And I'm coming to realize, you know, for my family, we are going to have to make it happen ourselves. We always celebrate Advent in our house. We like to light candles at supper and read the verses along with the lectionary. But this year we're going to dive into it more than ever. I think it's something that I'm looking forward to bring some structure and some joy into our lives, especially with our kids. My kids are 5 and 2, and they are already finding joy. One of the things that gives me hope is seeing their creativity and the excitement that they bring even to simple things. You can see behind me here, we've already started the decorating with snowflakes up on the wall. Those are probably going to be there till March now. But I'm looking forward to getting them involved. Instead of being able to go out to Christmas events, we're going to make it happen in our home this year. And I think it will be sacred and joyful in a new way, even if we can't be with our family and with our church family in the ways that we love to be at Christmas time. So I'm thinking of everyone this week as we begin this journey toward Bethlehem. May it be a time of reflection, and may you find warmth and joy in the midst of these increasingly dark and damp days that we have right now. So, Advent blessings of hope to you this week.
Our focus today reads this way: when the heart is moving in readiness, there is an openness to the new, perhaps the fresh thing God wants to do. To embrace the new requires letting go of the past. Repentance means we're letting go and making space for God's new work in us. That's our basic overall theme for today. I have a few announcements, and if anyone else has more, please come to the mic to give them. If you recall, not that long ago, Ernie helped us begin the process of what do we do as a church, name change and all those sorts of things. We will be looking at that, as council and elders, soon. We had hoped to do it this week, but the meeting is going to be postponed. But we want you to know it's not forgotten. And we will look at it, kind of the hows and the whens we further the process in the new year. So it's be assured that it's not forgotten.
Just a reminder for worship committee, we will try and meet on Wednesday. I'm not good at predicting weather, obviously. So hopefully we can meet on Wednesday at 12:30.
The weather looks favorable, I think.
Hopefully.
First of all, I wanted to let you know how appreciative Leah, our conference, or what you call executive minister, is that we pay attention to her view from here every Sunday morning. I indicated that to her when we had a council meeting 2 weeks ago, and she really appreciates. She says, you know, I do these things and I don't know whether or not people are paying attention or even listening. And I pointed out to her that we at Nairn Mennonite Church listen to it every Sunday whenever there is one, and she really appreciates that. So I wanted you to know that, and she sends her thanks for doing that. She's a very young person, but with an old soul, actually, and she's providing some very good leadership for our MCEC. So I want you to uphold her in our prayers. The second thing I wanted to mention is, we can use it as part of a prayer as well, but I thought it's a good thing to announce it now. With us going into orange, it means that there would be additional work for us at Craigwell Gardens, and it also means that we have to be a little more extra careful even in our interaction here. It does not affect how many people we have, because it still remains at 30% of our capacity, but we have to be a little more careful in terms of keeping our social distance and all of that kind of stuff. And I'm saying that to you because if we are not as careful as we're supposed to be, that means I may not be able to come to church because I have to be protective of the residents. And I really do want to come to church. So please just let us know that we just have to take an extra time or extra stuff. And so some meetings have been postponed and so on. That's a good thing because we're trying as much as possible to see what that is all about. Thanks.
Thanks, Ernie.
The little tree in the foyer needs to be decorated. Also, it would be nice if we could collect socks, mitts, hats, scarves, anything like that to hang on the tree to give to the thrift store food bank later.
Good idea. Thank you. It is wonderful to see everyone here today. As we continue then to prepare for worship, let's listen to Wayne's prelude. Please join me in our call to worship. Listen, a voice cries out in the wilderness.
Prepare the way of the Lord.
Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill made low.
Prepare the way of the Lord.
Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. Prepare the way of the Lord. And from Psalm 85, in part, and 2 Peter, hear this confession and words of assurance. We hear John the Baptist cry in the desert and are called to repentance.
We will hear what God the Lord will say.
The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, but patient, not wanting anyone to perish. Salvation is near to those who fear God. We receive the gift. Help us to walk in your way. We have our praise hymns next. Glory be to God, and then Take Thou My Hand, O Father, in between the hymns, so we have our Advent lighting Advent candle lighting.
Prepare the way of the Lord.
Our first scripture you see today is from Isaiah 40, the first 11 verses. Encourage God's people. Our God has said, encourage my people, give them comfort. Speak kindly to Jerusalem and announce your slavery is past. Your punishment is over. I, the Lord, made you pay double for your sins. Someone is shouting, clear a path in the desert. Make a straight road for the Lord our God. Fill in the valleys, flatten every hill and mountain. Level the rough and rugged ground. Then the glory of the Lord will appear for all to see. The Lord has promised this. Someone told me to shout, and I asked, what should I shout? We humans are merely grass, and we last no longer than the wild flowers. At the Lord's command, flowers and grass disappear, and so do we. Flowers and grass may fade away, but what our God has said will never change. There is good news for the city of Zion. Shout it as loud as you can from the highest mountains. Don't be afraid to shout to the towns of Judah. God is here. Look, the powerful Lord God is coming to rule with his mighty arm. He will bring with him what he has taken in war, and he rewards his people. The Lord cares for his nation, just as a shepherd cares for their flock. He carries the lamb in his arms. Can you picture that? He carries the lambs in his arms while gently leading the mother sheep. We are just blessed to have these words of assurance today. As we think about our offering now, and in a moment we'll listen to the prelude, remember that the tray is in the back, the basket is in the back table, and beginning this month, the coin offering is being gathered for the Oskegon Area Food Bank. Wait. We pray. We give thanks today for the blessings that you bestow on us, Father. And Father, forgive us for the times when we do not open our hands as wide as we could. I thank you, Father, for the monies received to help support this congregation and then for us to be able to support the broader church family. Thank you, Father, for those who helped fill our grocery basket today for our area food bank. Amen. The next hymn you see is On Jordan's Bank, A Baptist Cry, 183. Thank you. to be able to sing again. Someday it will happen. The next passage is from Matthew 3, the first 16 verses. And I've often wondered what happened before when the terms like years later are used at the beginning of today's passage from Matthew. In this reading, though, it's referring to the time when Jesus and his family returned from Egypt to live in Nazareth. So that was what happened before. Years later, John the Baptist started preaching in the desert of Judea. He said, "Turn back to God. The kingdom of heaven will soon be here." John was the one the prophet Isaiah was talking about when he said, "In the desert, someone is shouting, 'Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him.'" John wore clothes made of camel's hair and had a leather strap around his waist and ate grasshoppers and wild honey, can you imagine? From Jerusalem and all Judea and from the Jordan River Valley, crowds of people went to John. They told how sorry they were for their sins, and he baptized them in the river. Many Pharisees and Sadducees also came to be baptized, but John said to them, "You bunch of snakes, who warned you to run from the coming judgment? Do something to show that you really have given up your sins. And don't start telling yourself that you belong to Abraham's family. I tell you that God can turn these stones into children for Abraham. An axe is ready to cut down the trees at their roots. Any tree that doesn't bear good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into a fire. I baptize you with water so that you will give up your sins. But someone more powerful is coming, and I am not good enough even to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His threshing fork is in his hand, and he is ready to separate the wheat from the husks. He will store the wheat in his barn and burn the husks in a fire that never goes out." Again, we thank you for the Lord's word. And ask blessings on Art as he brings us the message, and then we should be ready to respond to his message immediately following. Art?
I have frequently been accused of delivering sermons that require people to think. Sometimes that's come as a criticism, and more often I hope it has come as an affirmation, because I freely own that comment. It is what I want to happen. But you may not have seen that as a call to repentance. But that's exactly what the word means. To turn around or to specifically think differently. Look at something from a new angle. Or even more simply, look at the same familiar thing a second time. And that's what this morning is all about. And as Jay has mentioned, several people have encouraged me to include the discussion period in our time together, so you can ask questions or make comments about what I share with you. And there's going to be a learning curve for all of us as we work at making that a vital part of our worship together. And this morning I'm asking that you try to distill the sermon into a few words that tell me what you heard as the central theme. You may also want to comment on what can block or what can ease the road to repentance. The road to repentance. Matthew's recording of the story of John the Baptizer has been immortalized in Handel's Great Messiah, and sung probably more than any other Christmas anthem ever written. There is little known about John outside of what Matthew and Luke tell us. But some traditions speculate that he was a member of a sect called the Essenes. It was like a monastic order that isolated itself from the mainstream of culture and religion in order to be more faithful, more in keeping with the law. If John was really a member of the Essenes, which many biblical scholars think he was, then he believed some very interesting things. He believed some things that shed new light for me on what he was talking about when he said, repent. One of those strange things that they believed was that the first set of laws that Moses, remember, in anger smashed to pieces were not the same as the Ten Commandments, the ones that we know today. They believed that even though the account in Deuteronomy and chapter 9 and 10 says that it was the same, the Essenes believed that the second set were a toned-down version of what God really wanted, because Moses was convinced that the first set was altogether too hard and nobody could keep them, let alone understand them. After all, when he came back with that first set, he found them worshiping a golden calf. They needed that kind of help to even think about God. The first set of commandments, the Essenes believed, represented what was really expected of anyone who would be a citizen in the kingdom of God. And Moses was convinced that the escaped slaves were simply not ready to obey, let alone understand what God expected of them. And he convinced God that the Ten Commandments would have to do for the time being. Now John was saying, get ready for the real thing. Something new is about to happen. So he called out, turn back to God. The kingdom of heaven will soon be here. Repent ye, for the kingdom of God is at hand, in that familiar translation. If he did stand in the tradition of the Essenes, what he was saying amounted to, now you are going to hear what God really wants, and God is going to make it happen. Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him. You have to rethink everything you have decided about what God wants of members of his kingdom. But more importantly, if we look carefully at the Old Testament information that John based his pronouncement on, it talks a lot more about what God wants for his people. We so often read it as it's what God wants us to do. It's what he wants for us. Listen to what I believe are the key words in the Isaiah passage from which John quotes. Encourage my people. Give them comfort. Speak kindly. Announce that their punishment is over. The valleys will be filled. Mountains and hills will be flattened. Crooked places will be made straight. Rough places smoothed out. That's the action of God. Not what he expects us to do. It's what he's going to do for us. Your God is here. He cares for his nation like a shepherd. All that the prophet asked of the people was to get ready. What was abundantly clear as we talked last week, they were not ready. And I have another bit of a suspicion about what was really on those first stone tablets that the Essene community believed Moses decided was too hard for the nation. Remember, Moses was leading a nation of people that had lived under slavery for generations. They were told what they could and could not do every day of their lives. Now they were free, like a ship without a rudder, a car without a driver, a kite without a string. Do you get the picture? All they could understand was an order, a command. The law just replaced a slave driver. The Essenes believed that the first tables were not laws at all. They were much more sophisticated. They were ideas about what it could be like in the kingdom of God. What was possible for these new free nation? So I wonder if they didn't look much more like the Beatitudes. They don't list off what we can and cannot do. They talk about what happens when we become a certain kind of person. Look at the first Beatitude. It does not tell us how to be merciful. It just points out what happens when we are. And the rest of the Beatitudes follow that same pattern. This is what happens when you are a certain kind of person. And maybe those first tablets reflected exactly the way that Jesus instructed his disciples to live. Love one another as I have loved you. Now there's a new thought, particularly for a bunch of slaves to try to understand. No one had ever loved them. That one requires a lot of rethinking, a lot of repentance. If you watch any United States television, you hear a lot today about law and order. That's what Moses was trying to create for the tribes of Israel, a community based on law and order. That nation of freed slaves could not even imagine a community based on love, love for one another. A totally different way. But then, can we understand it any better? Law and order protects us from one another. Love makes us available for one another. At one point, Jesus told his followers that he did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. He came to do what the law could never do. So often that is interpreted to mean that the law could never make us right with God. The law can't even make us right with one another. Jesus talked about the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. They did it right according to the law, but that was not near enough. You can obey the rules and the law, and at the same time you hold other people in contempt for not doing what you're doing. That was the exact criticism that Jesus leveled against those scribes and Pharisees. What the law could never do was to take us beyond ourselves, beyond our self-interest, to what some theologians called other love. The primary motivation for obeying the law is to protect oneself, to avoid punishment. But love is all for the benefit of somebody else in our lives. The road to repentance, the road to thinking that way, is not an easy road in some senses. Repentance is not so much about feeling shame as it is about taking a hard look at what drives our lives. What motivates us? Where are we trying to go? What do we focus on? What do we hope for, hold on to, or make central in the choices that we make? It's taking stock and deciding, is this really what we want to be? The word that we translate as sin that appears so often in that Matthew chapter literally means missing the mark, missing the target. Repentance may also include realizing that we're aiming at the wrong target. It's choosing a new focus. But on the other hand, the road to repentance is easy. It gets easier to love the more we are loved in return. But it gets easiest to love when we know that someone loves us first. And that is what the second candle on the Advent road is all about. But the road to repentance is also very short. It leads to an immediate experience of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is that close, just waiting for an act of love to prepare the way.
As we carry on this week and think about what we've heard today, and maybe hopefully speak with one another, talk with one another, encourage one another, we have our special, what are we calling ourselves, special friend, special something for this Advent season. Maybe that's a good point to dialogue somehow with that person. Our next hymn, as you see, is something, one of my favorites, I suppose, in Jesus' Calling, 491.
Thank you.
God does hear our prayers even though they're not spoken out loud. So please pray with me. Jesus, thank you for being the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Your ministry, while you were on this earth, showed us how we are to be, how we are to live our lives each day, showing compassion and forgiveness, love and kindness. Help us to remember that all people are your children. We pray, Father, that we may shed the shoulds and the oughts in our lives, the things that hold us back from being the Christ followers you wish us to be. We pray for the world and community leaders as they govern to the best of their abilities amid the crisis we are all in at this time. And Father, we pray for those who continue to believe that the current health crisis is not real. We lift up to you those among us who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries, and pray special blessings on them. We pray for this church, that we may be a light to the community that we are in. We give you thanks that we are able to come together in this space for worship. We long for the time, Father, when we can again share a cup of coffee or a tea, and maybe a cookie or two, and not be afraid to clasp hands or embrace one another. Jesus, we celebrate the joys shared this day, and we ask you to enfold in your arms those who shared concerns and the concerns that were not spoken. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
People on the road, something greater is coming. Prepare the way of the Lord. Go forth attuned to his Holy Spirit, making room for the light of the world. Go in peace.